Urba 2000 looks at examples of urban achievements from which Canadian cities might benefit. The Urba 2000 series grew out of the French language series Urbanos, which probed a wide range of urban problems as manifested in Montreal. The cities presented here are only an example of urban planning which attempts to respond to human environmental values and needs. They were chosen following 8 months of worldwide research on urban development. This film is an English version of the original French Urba 2000 series.
The purpose of Runcorn is to provide better living conditions for mainly Liverpool people where the position is rather desperate. And this is a new town, eventually to have 100,000 population. It starts with the existing township of Runcorn of 27,000, and the conception really is very simple. It is an endeavour to provide a balanced town in which the motor car has certain privileges, public transport has certain privileges, and people, perhaps most of all, have the privilege of walking about in safety from their homes to their, as far as the children are concerned, to their schools, and the parents to their social facilities, to the shopping centre and so on. I think if you approach Runcorn by car, you feel that the town is yours, and you can get anywhere in the town up to a certain point where the places where people live. But if you approach by bus, you perhaps arrive at the city centre, and there you get on the bus. Well, you feel that the world is yours too, because this bus has the right of way along special routes, and the traffic lights are so arranged that when they come to a crossing, the lights are in favour of the bus. Residential areas, you don't come across a car. You've got your special walkways. When you come across the busway, you go over a bridge or under a subway, so that although all the facilities are there, none of them are in conflict. Of course, this is not just a technical theory. In the end, the test of a new town is whether people are satisfied. And I think it's true to say that the people have found this simple bus service, which is a figure of eight in this way, they found this very convenient. The bus drivers, incidentally, have said that they feel that as though they were on holiday because they have no traffic in the way. They can go 30, 40 miles an hour. And the people, the passengers, complain that the journeys are too short. But of course, the principle is this, that the shopping city is at the center of the new town. This is virtually a very large air-conditioned box, which is split up into areas for shopping, social and commercial uses, and is elevated above the ground by approximately 20 feet. All of the shopping takes place at this upper level, but storage and other uses such as cinemas, squash courts, entertainment, public houses can take place below this level.
which is the level at which the ordinary vehicles service the centre. Pedestrians coming into the centre come into the corners from the valley side. They come along a horizontal footpath through the edge of the car park here and into the centre without having to go down or uphill. Likewise, the people on the busway come into the town centre on the busway here, get off the bus undercover and go down by escalator to the access level to the shopping. People who come on country buses come in at the ground level underneath that and come up to ground level here by escalator and also into the shopping centre. People coming to do their shopping trips by car come into, at present, the four multi-storey car parks sited in the four corners of the shopping area. This allows all people, whether walking on the bus or by car, to have easy, safe access into the centre, which is fully protected from the vagaries of the English weather.
This is not only a commercial centre, but also a service centre. Could you show us where both are located?
Yes, within the main shopping area here, there are some service uses. There are cinemas, there will be a dance hall and a social club. But in the northern loop of the road system here, we have commercial offices here, a police station, law courts, commercial offices here, and a public library there. And in a further phase of the shopping city to be built to the south, there will be other entertainment and commercial uses.
And a series of residential communities are linked by a bus route which goes through the centres of those communities. And at each centre is a bus stop. The bus stop is at the local shopping centre. So there's a link between the major shopping centre and the minor shopping centre. The schools are also located at the centre points. So that if you happen to go to a school in a different community, you can also go by bus. And everyone in each of these communities is within walking distance of their local shop and of the bus stop and of the school. In fact, there is a walking module that is the starting point of this town, that facilities are planned within walking distance. When they're outside that distance, well, you have to go by public transport along the figure of eight route, or you go by car if you wish. But the principle of the car, in the way it's arranged within the structure, is that it should have its main movements outside the town. There should be no through traffic. The roads are outside. They have their feeders in to each community, and in the middle is a town park.
And the style of the architecture we have here is very largely dictated by the site. The centre of the town, as you know, is this large rock with the ruins of the castle on it. And we very consciously made a decision that we would keep all of the buildings fairly low in relation to that, and also relate their colours and textures to the old sandstone colours of the rock. Hence the housing that you see around here on Hawk and Brown is in a brown brick, precisely chosen to match in with the colour of the old sandstone up here. Similarly, on other housing development, we've kept a very simple vocabulary of materials because we feel the most important aspects of this sort of development are the quality one can put into the landscaping and the importance of the people themselves.
Is it not too expensive to care so much about architecture?
Good architecture is a good investment.
More than anything else, all the people cater for now is emergency housing. They try and get people somewhere to live, just as a matter of course. You know, there's no thought of what they're leaving behind them when they move. And I think most people, especially from Liverpool, miss this. They miss all the background they've left behind, all the shopping even. You don't get the local shops here that you had in Liverpool, you know. And this is a big thing. They do miss it.
Here they get fresh air and they get green areas.
It's not much different really, the air. I don't think it's any fresher with all the industry surrounding us, you know.
What difference do you find between living in Liverpool and living in Runcorn?
Oh dear, the countryside, the fresh air, the shopping facilities, the house itself, everything. Completely different altogether.
Yes, but every small town offers the same advantages. In what way is Runcorn special?
It's everything. It's everything
you could need in Runcorn.
No.
It's very convenient. We've got a decent bus service.
There's every convenience for you up here. It's nice for the children, you know.
What are the reasons you moved here?
I think more or less for the kids, you know. Clean air. And, you know, they've never ailed since they've been up here. They've been sick, you know.
No, they've
been good.
You've got no danger roads or anything like that. You've got no worry at all. I don't think so, really.
Do you like Runcorn?
Like Runcorn?
Yeah.
What difference is there between life in Liverpool and life in Runcorn?
Well, the big difference for us was for the children, because where we lived before, you know, they couldn't play out because of the traffic. And here, you know, they're fairly well protected from the cars, and, you know, they like being able to play out, obviously.
Mrs. Armstrong, do you think people here have started acquiring a sense of community? Many people could lose this feeling as they feel much more lonely in the new towns than they did in Manchester or Glasgow.
No, I don't think so, really. I think they've got everything going for them, really. Whereas a person, say they moved from Scotland to Liverpool, they're a complete unknown, whereas here there's all sorts of organisations, different clubs and that. There's a play school, several play schools to take their children to. There's the ordinary schools, there's clinics, there's the community centres. They all hold various functions, don't they? And we've got every opportunity to mix and to make
friends.
I think
with everybody being new as well. You know, if you sort of just moved your family to a separate town, you'd be the one new person and a stranger to everybody, you know.
Yes.
Whereas I think the people coming here, everybody's new. I mean, we haven't been here a year ourselves, yes. And I think I know more people since I moved here than I'd ever did in the 30 years I lived where I was before, you know.
It's a sort of a chain reaction.
Once you have developed the land into residential or industrial areas, do you sell it back or do you keep it?
On industrial sites, we keep the freehold of the land and lease sites or rent factories to the clients. The corporation build standard nursery factories for small industrialists coming into the town, but also lease sites to the larger industrialists for the special plants, such as this aluminium extrusion plant and a furniture making factory shortly to be constructed here. For residential development, we either rent the houses to the occupants, houses that we built ourselves, or we sell the freehold of the land to builders to build houses for sale.
When one walks or travels through Runcorn, one gets the impression it's a very industrial city, surrounded by factories. Don't you think the residential and industrial districts are too close together?
I don't think the new industrial areas are too close to the new housing areas. The closest we have is the situation of Aspermore and Runcorn here, where they are separated by a canal and an expressway, because all of the new industries coming into Runcorn are in fact clean industries. They're not the old chemical industries, which are sited in the older part of the town, below the hill over here.
Is this new town trying to reach a minimum goal of one job per family?
No. I think you have to recognize in Runcorn that it is a new town within a region. It's the part of the Merseyside, and you can hardly separate Merseyside from the Manchester conurbation. I mean, what it comes to is that you can never stop people travelling a reasonable distance to their work. And it would be unrealistic in Runcorn to say that it should be completely self-contained so far as employment was concerned. Even if you started off in that way, you couldn't guarantee it for the future, because the parents might work or the father might work in a factory, but the children can't be controlled, not even by their parents, as to where they will work. If they find a new job and it's well paid, they'll go off to back to Liverpool, if they've come from Liverpool or across the Mersey to Widnes. So, in the main, of course, it's sensible if people don't have very far to travel to work. And I would imagine, we estimated in the plan that there would be something like 30% or 33 1/3% of the people employed outside, that is the employed force. I believe actually it's slightly more than that at the moment. And I don't see anything wrong in this. I think it's healthy that Runcorn should play its part in the general mixture of industry.
But why choose Runcorn? Why not renew the slum districts in downtown Manchester or Liverpool? Runcorn doesn't seem to solve the real problems. This new town concept seems to me like a utopia, maybe.
Well, you present these propositions to me as alternatives, but new towns are not alternatives to reconstruction, rehabilitation of slum areas in the big cities. They are an essential part of what you might call a combined operation. You release the pressure in the big cities, in Manchester and Liverpool, by taking people out to new towns. And when you've released, when you've relieved the pressure, then you can have the opportunity, with less people there, and particularly if you can arrange for it to coincide with a particular area, you can have the opportunity of redevelopment, rehabilitation. And so the new town helps the old. This is the purpose of the exercise.
What is the origin of the new town concept in England?
The real origin of new towns in England is a book by a man called Ebenezer Howard, published in the year 1898, and now known under the title Garden Cities of Tomorrow. Howard first put forward the idea that the population of big cities should be decentralized into new communities, he called them garden cities, in the countryside. And the jobs would be taken out as well as the people, so there would be no need for long distance commuting back into the cities. Howard said that in this way you could provide all the advantages of living in a town with all the advantages of living in the country, hence the name Garden City. And he advocated grouping garden cities in clusters so as to make what he called social cities. That was new planned urban agglomerations. The idea didn't catch on for a very long time, but of course after World War II it did in Britain in a rather big way.
Many people think of these projects as utopias, saying that one can't be in the country and in the town at the same time.
Well, Howard very specifically said that he wasn't utopian. He was against utopian ideas. He said his idea was very practical. In fact, most of the book is full of hard facts about how you would actually build the town and how you would pay for it. In fact, I think Howard was right that by creating rather small communities and putting green belts around them, you could perform the trick of having people live in a town but also appearing to live in the country at the same time. The essence was that you'd have small towns but built in clusters so that no one would be very far from the open countryside, but all of them would have access to a very large range of jobs and a very large range of urban services.
So now in England, how is a site chosen to build a new town or a city singled out to become an expanding town?
Well, broadly, the new towns in Britain fall into two groups. One group is to provide for Howard's original idea of decentralizing people from the big urban agglomerations. So we have over 10 new towns for London. In fact, there are now 11 of them. We have new towns for Birmingham, new towns for Manchester, new towns for Liverpool, new towns for Glasgow. But we also have a group of new towns which are solely intended to promote regional development in parts of the country which are not performing as well economically as the rest of the country. Some of those also serve the purpose of overspill from the agglomerations in those parts of the country. Most of the new towns are in fact providing for Howard's original purpose of urban overspill.
And what's the difference between new towns and expanding towns?
There is a technical difference between new towns, as we call them, and expanding towns. But it isn't a very real difference if you see these towns on the ground. The difference is that new towns are built by what we call development corporations. These are more or less autonomous corporations which get their money directly from the treasury of the central government and are largely independent of the local government in the area. The expanding towns, on the other hand, are built by agreement between the local government in the area, generally a borough, and the exporting authority in the big agglomeration. So they result from agreement between two or sometimes three local authorities to build the town, and they share the financial burden, but they get some of the money back from the central government. But in practice, an expanding town often looks exactly like a new town.
Do you think in an expanding town one can expect the same socio-cultural life as in older cities?
I think you can manage to get the same cultural life that you get in an old town over time. But it's going to take a very long time. After all, the working class culture in the old towns of Britain was a very distinctive one. The worker went to the football match on a Saturday afternoon to support his own team. He afterwards went to the pub and maybe spent the whole of Saturday night there. There was a pub on every street corner. Now, it's very difficult to reproduce this in a new town, even if you wanted to. The result is that the workers in Cumbernauld in Scotland, for instance, will go back to Glasgow to support their football team on a Saturday afternoon, and then they may stay in the Glasgow pubs, because there aren't so many pubs in Cumbernauld, and maybe they just don't have the same character. Maybe it's impossible ever to recreate that character. And to some extent, the new towns may create a different pattern of social life altogether.
Don't you think it's just a matter of time? Maybe 20 years from now, they'll have their own team.
I think in time, the new towns will grow to a size where they have their own football team. But by that time, I think the pattern of working class life will have changed. You just cannot reproduce that old